Cheryl Sandberg talk this morning, and we know what the data says. But I'm not going to talk about the data, or I don't have any statistics here. But if there were more women in technology, would it impact you and me? Would it make a difference for you and me personally if there were more women in technology? And I'm going to go back a little and tell you my little story. So I always wanted to do computer science since I think I was 11. And I did that when I was in school. I finished with doing a computer science major when I was in 11th and 12th. And then I picked up my engineering major as information technology. And I was through 5 semesters in college, and I'm thinking, okay, I'm here, I'm supposed to be realizing my dream. I've learned all this stuff, learning about what I wanted to learn, but what am I really doing? Am I getting where I want to get? And I knew that at that rate, I was going to end up in a big MNC, one among a lack of people probably. And I had this one dream always that wherever I worked, my work should matter. And I knew at that rate, I was not going to end up there, but I didn't know what to do about it. So I think for most people, I know the story ends there. They either went to IT jobs or they just, you know, quit the whole idea. So after this, something that happened to me that I'm really grateful for. So I also already spoke about this, but a lot of us have this tale in common. We had this event called 32-hour startup in my college. So it was one of the first idea, the prototype marathon kind of event that happened in India. So we had it at college, and I met most of my favorite mentors today there. There is Thorai, there is Yubi. So what happened was, I was an organizer at my college, entrepreneurship said, and I used to document there. So there were these other guys who were into technical help and stuff like that, and I went there and they used to spray terms like SSH, Git, and I used to look at them, what are you talking about? And it went on like that, and I was just sitting there. I had to stay there in the night and document what people were doing. And so it happened that Yubi, who now works in the Wikimedia Foundation, he said, okay, let's also build something. So over that night, I had like heard over 200 jargons. I picked up names of so many languages and so many frameworks and APIs. And we did end up building something. It was a very small hack. But at the end of it, I knew what I wanted to do. I knew I wanted to do this thing. I wanted to write code. So from that event, I went on to get into the Google Summer of Code program. And I think from installing my first Linux desktop when I was in my third year to presenting my work for the GNOME Foundation where I interned for my GSOC, it all happened in a very small period of like 6 months. So that was in Germany where I presented at the desktop summit. So I'm just at the beginning of my career, and I don't know it all, but I'm going to share a few things that I think you can all do if you want to really get started in this career. So the first thing is, yes, learn to code and learn it yourself. You don't learn it in the classroom. Nobody teaches you how to actually write code. Whatever you learn in class will not apply outside class at all. Nothing will help you actually. I started interning at the company where I work at right now. I started interning when I was in my final year. And I learned so much in that 3 months, more than what I learned in that entire 3.5 years of college. So nothing of what you learn in college actually applies. So learn to code and learn it yourself. So these are some of the resources. Code.org was the video you just saw. There is Codecademy. You have interactive tutorials on learning various languages. They have Ruby, they have Python, and they also have JavaScript. And there is Coursera. It's a website that has courses from Stanford, from almost all the major universities, even IIT they have in the world. So they have all these courses put up there free. You can actually take up the entire course. You get certificates for finishing the courses right from straight from the Stanford University. or whichever university course on. And yes, write code. And just don't write code. Solve some problem. Solve a real problem by writing code. So, I never believed in picking up a language and then writing some sample projects for it and storing it in your computer and forgetting about it. So instead, whatever you feel, like you came to this event today, if you felt something was missing, if you felt there could have been something better, why don't you go and try and solve it? So I think that was one of the ideas that we had in college. So we wanted to print badges for all our events. Unluckily, I don't have those here. But we wanted to print badges, and we didn't know, we did write small scripts to do that. But it was a repetitive process. Every event that you conduct, you have to redesign the way you wrote the script. So then we solved it by writing an entire app that lets you interactively, go there, put in a template, pick up, your attendee list and design your badge. And you never know what happens when you start solving real problems. We won this Google Apps Developer Challenge. And I think worldwide, we were first in the India region because we built that app. It's called Badgit. And the other thing is contribute to free and open source software. I'm not going to go very deep into free and open source software. I'm just going to touch the surface. So this was an idea that was... that sprang off from the early 90s, where the founder of Linux, Linus Torvalds, who first wrote Linux, he wrote Linux, and at that time there was this thing that all the software that you used, they were all commercially licensed. You couldn't see the source code, and they were all you used to get only the binaries. You really can't read code. You can't modify it. They wanted to block that. So they revolutionized the whole thing. That's how the Linux desktop came about, and. After that, this whole open source software revolution came up. So the idea, the code they wrote, they published it. It was free for anyone to take it, modify it, distribute it, sell it, as long as they kept the source code free. So that helped grow a huge community. Once you've written one small project, you can put it out there as an open source project. You can get people to contribute, interested people contribute to your project, and you build up some name for yourself as having written software that contributed to solve somebody's problem, as well as they got the sense of contribution. It's very, very pleasing when you contribute to open source, because there are like huge projects. Shyamla here is going to talk about Drupal next. When you contribute to these projects that are shipping worldwide, and you've written this small piece of code that everybody is using all over the world, it feels really great. And yes, find a partner in crime. You can't do all this alone. So, in my case, I had my friend here, Karthik. We've been writing code together since college. If you don't find just one partner, you can find so many partners. There are huge communities out here that help you. There is GDZ here, my most favorite community, Chennai Geeks. So at Chennai Geeks, we have monthly meetups, we have hackathons every 2 months, and you won't believe the kind of community there. When you run a hackathon, you don't have to even look for sponsorship. People will come and pour it to you. That's the kind of community there. They just want to help people become better programmers, become better solution providers. So we have a lovely community to help you. So if you want to write code, you don't have somebody in your class, somebody next to you who has the same interest as you. You have this huge community. You have it everywhere. There are so many of them. If you're interested in a specific language, there are user groups specific to that language. So you can find the community and work with them. And yes, read. And read a lot. So I'm not going to elaborate on that, but it really helps. To read a lot when you're a programmer. It's not just reading coding books or stuff like that. Reading general blogs. These are some of my favorite blogs. So reading these, you don't become better programmers, right? As in, you do become better programmers, but you don't actually learn to write code by reading these blogs. But overall, it one, inspires you, and two, it helps you keep your focus. And whenever you feel, you know, oh my god, why am I doing all this? So if you go back and read some of these blogs, you'll want to stay focused. And the last thing, don't settle. What I mean by settling is, if you're going to your job on day two feeling that I'm doing this just for the sake of doing this, you're settling. If you're doing it just for the sake of money, if you're doing it just for, you have to do it, you've already settled. Don't settle. Every day when you go to your work or whatever you're doing, you should feel that, yes, I'm supposed to be doing this. This is what I am doing. Don't do it for any other reason than that. And do whatever it takes for that. Any questions? Anything random, how to get into programming or anything like that?
Scenario in mind and you wanted to implement it along with some sort of inquisitiveness, it will drive you along. So it will by default take you to the way where you desire to go. So that's all my thought is. Yes.
And be ready to break boundaries that your peers put on you. Somebody came and told you, oh, it's fine, don't always be doing something. Or if somebody came and told you, oh, you have your exams, just be ready to put it aside and go and do what you really want to do. Forget attendance, forget 9 points, and just get at what you want to be doing. Otherwise, life will suck.
It happened to me. I had 9 or 8.9 till I was in my for the first 5 semesters. And then I started doing all this and I got 6.86. But I was the department topper, but I wasn't after I started all this stuff. But it didn't matter. I think I'm better paid and better job than almost all of my 9-pointer friends right now. So it's okay.
And join communities. Definitely join communities.
Yeah.
Community.
You should be on GDG, you should be on Chennai Geeks. And there are so many awesome mentors. You can contact me also. There are so many people who will be ready to help you on a day-to-day basis. So there is nothing to stop you except yourself.
And read those guys like the blogs she put out.
I know.
They just.
I will put this put the slides up on the website.
Yeah. I just wanted to add one thing.
Yeah, it's on my website. Yes.
Problem is, you know, when you hit a mental block, you know, what do I do, something changes and you know, you're not able to think through and you break off. So in that kind of case, if you have somebody working with you, then you know, you can get through all these kind of mental blocks, you know, very easily. So that helps a lot.